Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it is Azure Friday. I'm here with Emily Lawton and we're talking about Cosmos DB again, except this time the Spark connector. Okay.
Yeah.
Two things I haven't plugged together in my brain yet. You got Cosmos DB and Apache Spark.
Yep. So as we all know, real-time data is incredibly prevalent around us today. And people love to use Cosmos DB as the way to query and persist that real-time data for web, mobile, IoT applications. And Cosmos also has support for a number of aggregation functions, such as sum, min, average, count. But if you're a data scientist, some of these functions aren't sufficient for the types of complex querying and analytics that you want to do over your data. So I'm excited to be here today to talk about this new connector we have to bring together Spark and Cosmos DB. And essentially what this connector allows is Cosmos DB can act as an input source or an output sink for Apache Spark jobs.
Oh, okay. So if I've got a huge amount of data in Cosmos or I want to use Cosmos to store a huge amount of data, yeah. I'm already doing Spark, it just plugs right in?
Yep.
It just works?
Yes.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Is it an open source connector?
This connector is open source. If you go to our GitHub, you can see all the samples and how to get started and ramped up on it.
And do you have some actual live demos where you've plugged this in right now?
We do, and I'll go through one shortly.
Okay.
But I also want to acknowledge the kind of the two advantages of bringing these two services together. Now, with Spark, you can do very complex aggregated distributed aggregations over your data.
Okay.
And Cosmos, what that brings to the table is your access to the real-time data itself. And everything that comes along with a fully managed database service like we have. Automatic indexing, turnkey global distribution, all of those great features you get as well.
Do you think that Cosmos is like the best place to put Spark data? Like there's lots of places you could put data that comes from Spark, right?
Yeah, well the fact that Cosmos DB is just fully managed and with such great SLAs, it is a really great place to keep your data.
And you use that term aggregations. I'm not super familiar with that. Like the sum function is a kind of aggregate?
Yeah. So what Spark actually does is distributes out this kind of these kinds of functions to a bunch of worker nodes that then do all the work on smaller amounts of the data, and then it's aggregated back together. That's where the power of Spark really lies.
Okay. So it takes a count or sum or min or max or whatever, and it says, do it across all of these.
Yeah.
Spark is smart, does all the math, the mathy stuff, right? And then, of course, combined with another smart global database, which is the Cosmos DB, you get the best of all worlds.
Exactly.
That's cool.
So let's jump over to this Python notebook here that we have. Python
Please.
Notebooks are what a lot of people, data scientists who use Spark are most familiar with. So before we actually jump into a demo, let's look at this diagram of the architecture of how this connector is actually built.
Okay.
So when a user makes a connection between a master or between Spark and Cosmos, what's actually happening under the hood is that a Spark master node is connected to a Cosmos DB gateway node to get the partition information from Cosmos.
Okay.
That information is translated back to Spark and is then distributed among the worker nodes, which can then interact when a query comes in. They know which partition in Cosmos to access and can bring the data back to Spark for the worker nodes to kind of do their work on.
And is this largely transparent?
Like yeah,
as someone who's using this
is all
really
like the user is not aware of what's actually happening here.
Cool.
So these first cells, I already pre-baked them. I'm going to skip over them because they are just specifying the jars, the Spark jars, and defining how the connector should actually talk to Cosmos.
Okay.
And this next cell creates the flights. So I should give some context on this demo first. This is 3 months of on-time flight performance data from the United States Department of Transportation statistics.
Oh, wow. So hundreds of thousands, millions of flights?
There's a lot of flights here.
Okay.
I don't think millions, but hundreds of thousands. And so we create a Spark data frame here, which is essentially just a distributed collection of the flight data that's organized into named columns. It's almost like a relational table, in fact.
Okay.
So the first query we're actually going to do here is calculate the top 10 delayed destinations originating from Seattle.
Cool.
So if we run this here.
These would be the places not to go.
Yeah, and if we look at the bar graph, you can see that the flights to San Francisco from Seattle are most often delayed.
Oh, wow.
Are most delayed. Mm-hmm. And then something that, another query we can do that has a function that is definitely not built in Cosmos,
right,
is we can calculate the median delays by destination cities departing from Seattle. And this uses Spark's percentile approximation function, which, again, if you're interested in math or algorithms, I think it's doing some sort of algorithm similar to a hyperlog log. So it's doing an estimation function, but it's still very accurate.
So it's quite a sophisticated aggregate across a huge amount of data.
Yeah, exactly. And here we see that the city, the flight from Seattle to Cleveland actually has the greatest median delay of 12 minutes. And other interesting, it's not terrible. Other interesting things that you can do with the connector are actually do graph queries as well. Mm-hmm. And so what these cells actually do is create a graph frame, which is composed of vertex and edge data frames. A vertex data frame contains a column, a special column named ID, which contains the ID of the vertex. And the edge data frames contain a source and input column.
Okay.
With the vertex of the input, the source vertex and destination vertex ID. And so we can actually figure out the most important airport in terms of like the number of connections going through that airport.
Oh, I see. So we walk the whole graph. This is, a quite a sophisticated aggregate across a large amount of data.
So this would take like a lot of grouping and it would take some time to compose a SQL query that could do this. But here we see with Spark, we can just use the graph degree method and quickly find that, as expected,
Atlanta.
If you know a lot about flights, Atlanta has the greatest number of connections going through it, followed by Dallas and Chicago.
And it's so fast.
Yeah, it's very fast. That's largely the power of Spark combined with Cosmos. But they work great together. Another interesting query that we can do is see if there are any direct flights between two cities. So I picked San Jose and Buffalo here.
Mm-hmm.
So this is using Spark's breadth-first search function. And if we set the max path length to 1, that means there is no stop in between those two points.
Okay.
And this query returns no results, meaning that there are no paths of length 1 between these two cities.
Okay.
So let's try to actually increase the max path length to 2.
So this is seeing if there are flights between Seattle and Buffalo that have...
With one stop.
One stop, two edges, okay.
And this one is taking a little longer.
Oh, and there's a ton.
There are a lot, and so we can see that of the top 20 that are shown here, they all stop in Boston in between. So there are two legs of the flight, that's why the path length is 2. And you can see that this took only very simple query to do this.
This might be a dumb question, but if I were going to try to do these kinds of queries with Cosmos directly, would I have trouble because I don't have the aggregates available that I'd want to have?
We don't have these kinds of this BFS function. In SQL syntax, this would be very difficult to do.
Mm.
But if you're not already aware, we actually do have an API for Gremlin, which is also an Apache graph way of querying documents. You could also do something similar using that, but I think Spark will be much faster.
So when I make a decision about to include Apache Spark in my Cosmos kind of ecosystem of data, do I need to be thinking about the kinds of data that I store and the shape of the data? Like if I just had a table of books, I probably don't need this.
Yeah, I think that's very important, and the cool goal of a roadmap for Cosmos is being able to have multiple APIs so users can, depending on their data set, query with different APIs and use the API that will give them the best performance and makes most sense.
And that's one of the cool things about Cosmos is that it supports those multiple APIs.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So I can talk to this with Jupyter. What else can I do?
So this is the main way. We also have support for Scala. If you like programming in Scala, we also have some tools for that. I think Python is the main language that people who are using Spark use. So this is generally what we direct people to use, and we have most support for it. If you go to our GitHub, it's github.com/Azure. I can show it to you in a moment. /Azure Cosmos DB Spark. And we have a bunch of performance tips, tools on how to just get ramped up, a number of samples, other Python notebooks of other sorts of scenarios that you can go through yourself and download. And yeah, there are a lot of resources.
Can I do ML
there.
Algorithms with Spark?
Yeah, I was actually just going to, I don't think we have time to go through this whole demo here, but you can also, using like a data set that you have in Cosmos, you can split it into, with Spark, a training set and a test set. You can train a model on your training data. You can make predictions. So what this demo actually does is predicts whether a flight will be delayed or not. Mm-hmm. And so you can create your ML pipeline. And in this example, we ran a logistic regression model. Mm-hmm. And I actually did pre-bake this. And this is a confusion matrix that shows the results of...
What is a confusion matrix?
It shows like the number. It splits up if you're testing the evaluating whether an ML model is good or not. Mm-hmm. You can see what the percentages of times it corrected, it guessed whether a flight would be delayed. Or if the flight is delayed, how many times did it actually predict that flight would be delayed?
Uh-huh.
If a flight was not delayed.
How often it was right, how often it
was
wrong.
Yeah, exactly. So if we sum up the true negatives and the true positives here, meaning when the algorithm was correct, we see that we can predict with over 70% accuracy whether a flight was delayed or not, which is not bad. And this whole model you can train and run in about 5 minutes. Don't have time now, but yeah.
That's amazing. Now, can people use the Spark connector for Cosmos today?
They can. If you go to our wiki, this is all in public preview. You can download the tools, you can get started, run these samples on your own, and experiment and do whatever your heart desires.
Very cool. Well, thank you so much for getting me up to speed.
Yeah, no problem.
All right. I am learning all about the Spark connector for Azure Cosmos DB here on Azure Friday.